So, hello and welcome everybody to another reading of Babylon Mystery Religion from Jörg from YouTube channel Joggler66, Hour of the Truth. Today I have on my agenda to read at least chapter 20, which is called The Winter Festival, and I will see how far it takes me because chapter 21 is not that big, much bigger, so it's possible I combine these two readings, but I'll see as I go along how it works out. Then otherwise the book will even be finished today with the reading with the last two chapters. But we start at chapter 20 now, called The Winter Festival, of course. This deals with the so-called Christmas. Yeah, where the winter solstice has nothing to do with Christ and everything to do with Mass. Eh? It's a mess in one way, and it's a mess in the Catholic way when they hold Mass, you know. But you can also say it's a mess, M-E-S-S. Anyway, Christmas, December 25th, this is the day designated on our calendars as the day of Christ's birth. You know, because we all use a Roman Catholic calendar. We use the Gregorian calendar. Before that we used the Julian calendar, and none of us is using the God-given calendar, which is a moon calendar, not a sun calendar. S-U-N, sun-worshipping Rome gives us the calendar that we adhere to. But is this really the day on which he was born? Well, interesting question. I've dealt with that already in some other videos, but let's see what this book has to say about it. December 25th. Is this really the day on which he was born, Christ? Are today's customs at this season of Christian origin? Well, after all we've seen this far in this book, we can assume no, but let's see. Or is Christmas another example of mixture between S-U-N sun worship, paganism and Christianity? What do you think? A look at the word Christmas indicates that it is a mixture. Though it includes the name of Christ, it also mentions the Mass, M-A-S-S, which to me is sometimes more an M-E-S-S, a mess. When we consider all of the elaborate ceremonies, prayers for the dead, transubstantiation rites, and complicated rituals of the Roman Catholic Mass, can any truly link this with the historical Jesus of the Gospels? His life and ministry were uncomplicated by such ritualism. As Paul, we fear that some have been corrupted from the simplicity that is in Christ, as we read in 2 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 3, quote, "But I fear lest by any means, as the serpent beguiled Eve through his subtlety, so your minds should be corrupted from the simplicity that is in Christ." Unquote. Because of S-U-N sun-worshipping pagan influence upon such things as the Mass. Looking at this way, the word Christmas is self-contradictory. As to the actual date of Christ's birth, December 25th is to be doubted. When Jesus was born, quote, "There were in the same country shepherds abiding in the field, keeping watch over their flock by night," unquote, as we can read in Luke chapter 2, verse 8. Shepherds in Palestine did not abide in the fields during the middle of winter. Adam Clark has written, quote, "As these shepherds had not yet brought home their flocks, it is a presumptive argument that October had not been yet commenced, and that consequently our Lord was not born on the 25th of December, when no flocks were out in the fields. On this very ground, the Nativity in December should be given up." Unquote. Well, whether this book deals with this subject or it doesn't, I tell you there is a even more sure, very, very sure reason to know that Jesus was born around the time of September. Because when you go into the 70-week prophecy of Daniel in chapter 9, you know that Messiah was cut off in the midst of the week. The week, the 70th week, which is not future. the 70th week, which our Messiah Jesus Christ fulfilled completely almost 2,000 years ago. In the midst of the week, he's be cut off. That was as the at the Passover. So, when at the Passover he was cut off in the midst of the week, and 3.5 years before he got baptized, when he was 30 years old, as the law commands that anybody who is ministering as a rabbi is to be baptized at 30 years old and then can start his ministry, he must have had his birthday about September, when he died somewhere about the end of March, April, the month Abib, as we are taught in the Bible to count the times. This to me is the most important reason to know that Jesus Christ was not born in the 25th of December. Of course, the book deals with a lot of other subjects and other reasons, but this to me is the most important one. And of course, if you deny that Daniel 9 is completely fulfilled, verses 24 to 27, and the vision is sealed up, when you deny that, you are worshipping another Christ, not Jesus Christ, not our Messiah. So you have to take that literally, and he gave up, he ended the sacrifices, he did an end to the sacrifices and oblations in the midst of the week, and he gave up his life, and not for his own. And in the midst of the week, when a week is 7 days, or in this case 7 years, the midst of it is 3.5 years, and 3.5 years in the midst, and Passover, which is in March, April, around half a year before that, must have been the time where he was born. Otherwise, he was not baptized when he was 30 years old. So you see how easy it is to see through the lies of the Roman Catholic Church. Just when you understand the Word of God, just when you read the Bible, while the Bible does not expressly tell us the date of Jesus' birth, there are indications it was probably in the fall of the year. We know that Jesus was crucified in spring at the time of the Passover, as I already said. And we can also read, therefore, in confirmation, John 18, verse 39, quote, "But ye have a custom that I should release unto you one of the Passover. Will ye therefore that I release unto you the King of the Jews?" Unquote. Figuring his ministry as lasting 3.5 years, this would place in the beginning of his ministry in fall, as I just stated. At that time he was about to be 30 years of age, as we can read for confirmation in Luke chapter 3, verse 23, quote, "And Jesus himself began to be about 30 years of age, being, as was supposed, the son of Joseph, which was the son of Heli." Unquote. The recognized age for a man to become an official minister under the Old Testament, as we can read in chapter 4 of Numbers, verse 3, quote, "From 30 years old and upward, even until 50 years old, all that enter into the host to do the work in the tabernacle of the congregation." Unquote. If he turned 30 in the fall, then his birthday was in the fall, 30 years before. At the time of Jesus' birth, Joseph and Mary had gone to Bethlehem to be taxed, as we can read in Luke chapter 2, verses 1 through 5. Verse 15, sorry. Quote, "And it came to pass, as the angels were gone away from them into heaven, the shepherds said one to another, Let us now go even unto Bethlehem, and see this thing which is come to pass, which the Lord hath made known unto us." Unquote. There are no records to indicate that the middle of winter was the time of taxing. A more logic time of the year would have been in the fall, at the end of the harvest. If this was the case, it would have been the season for the Feast of Tabernacles at Jerusalem, which could explain why Mary went with Joseph, as we can read in Luke chapter 2 and verse 41. Quote, "Now his parents went to Jerusalem every year at the Feast of the Passover." Unquote. This would also explain This would also explain why Mary went with Joseph, and this would also explain why even at Bethlehem there was no room in the inn, as we can read in Luke chapter 2, verse 7, quote, "And she brought forth her firstborn son and wrapped him in swaddling clothes and laid him in the manger, because there was no room for them in the inn," unquote. According to Josephus, Jerusalem was normally a city of 120,000 inhabitants, but during the feasts, sometimes as many as 2 million Jews would gather. Imagine that. A city of normally 120,000 inhabitants all of a sudden has almost 18 times that number. Such vast crowds not only filled Jerusalem, but the surrounding towns also, including Bethlehem, which was only 5 miles to the south. If the journey of Mary and Joseph was indeed to attend the feast, as well as to be taxed, this would place the birth of Jesus in the fall of the year. It is not essential that we know the exact date on which Christ was born. And I think that if it was essential, God would have told us. And if it was essential to have a feast on our birthday, God would have told us the same thing. A birthday is nothing. I'm born again every morning when I wake up from my sleep. And I thank God for that. It's not essential that we know the exact date on which Christ was born. The main thing being, of course, that he was born. The early Christians commemorated the death of Christ, as we can read in 1 Corinthians 11, verse 26, quote, "For as often as ye eat this bread and drink of this cup, ye do show the Lord's death till he come," unquote. So, Christ's death was commemorated, not his birth. The Catholic Encyclopedia says, quote, "Christmas was not among the earliest festivals of the Church. Irenaeus and Tertullian omitted from their lists of feasts," unquote. Later, when churches at various places did begin celebrating the birthday of Christ, there was much difference of opinion as to the correct date. It was not until the latter part of the 4th century before the Roman Church began observing December 25th. Yet, by the 5th century, it was ordering that the birth of Christ be forever observed on this date, even though this was the day of the old Roman feast of the birth of Sol, one of the names of the sun god. Says Fraser, quote, "The largest sun sun-worshipping pagan religious cult which fostered the celebration of December 25th as a holiday throughout the Roman and Greek worlds was the sun worship, Mithraism. This winter festival was called the Nativity of the Sun. Was this sun sun-worship festival responsible for the December 25th day being chosen by the Roman Church? We will let the Catholic Encyclopedia answer." You know, it's not our words, it's even from the mouth of the horse itself. Quote, "The well-known solar feast of Natalis Invicti, the nativity of the unconquered sun, celebrated on 25th of December, has a strong claim on the responsibility for our December date." Unquote. Can you be any more clear than this? Just listen to their own words, and your ears will fall from your head and your eyes will fall out of your carcass. Because if you don't believe what they say themselves, and you don't believe what the Bible says, well, then you don't believe anything, do you? It comes from their own mouth, the well-known solar feast of Natalis Invicti, the unconquered sun, celebrated December 25th, had a strong claim on the responsibility for our December date. Says the Catholic Encyclopedia itself. A sun worship solar customs, as sun worship solar customs were being Christianized at Rome, it is understandable that confusion would result. Some thought Jesus was Sol, S-O-L, the S-U-N, sun god. Quote, Tertullian had to assert that Sol was not the Christian god. Augustine denounced the heretical identification of Christ with Sol. Pope Leo I bitterly reproved solar festivals. Christians, on the very doorstep of the Apostles' Basilica, turning to adore the rising S-U-N. Unquote. The winter festival was very popular in ancient times. In sun-worshipping Rome and Greece in the days of the Teutonic barbarians, in the remote times of ancient Egyptian civilization, in the infancy of the race east and west and north and south, the period of the winter solstice was ever a period of rejoicing and festivity. Because this season was so popular, it was adopted as the time of the birth of Christ by the Roman Church. Some of our present-day Christmas customs were influenced by the Roman Saturnalia. Quote, says one writer, it is common knowledge that much of our association with Christmas season, the holidays, the giving of presents, and the general feeling of geniality, is but the inheritance from the Roman winter festival of Saturnalia, survivals of the paganism, survivals of paganism, survivals of S-U-N sun worship. Unquote. Tertullian mentions that the practice of exchanging presents was a part of the Saturnalia. There is nothing wrong in giving presents, of course. The Israelites gave gifts to each other at times of celebration, even celebrations that were observed because of mere custom, as we can read in Esther chapter 9, verse 22. Quote, as the days wherein the Jews rested from their enemies, and the month which was turned unto them from sorrow to joy, and from mourning into a good day, that they should make them days of feasting and joy, and of sending portions one to another, and gifts to the poor. Unquote. But some have sought to link Christmas gifts with those presented to Jesus by the wise men. This cannot be correct. By the time the wise men arrived, Jesus was no longer lying in a manger, as when the shepherds came, but was in a house. And for confirmation, we read Matthew chapter 2, verse 9 through 11. Quote, when they had heard the king, they departed, and lo, the star which they saw in the east went before them, till it came and stood over where the young child was. When they saw the star, they rejoiced with exceeding great joy, and when they were come into the house, they saw the young child with Mary his mother, and fell down and worshipped him. And when they had opened their treasures, they presented unto him gifts, gold, frankincense, and myrrh. Unquote. This could have been quite a while after his birthday. Also, they presented their gifts to Jesus, not to each other. The Christmas tree, as we know it, only dates back a few centuries, though ideas about sacred trees are very ancient. An old Babylonish fable told of an evergreen tree which sprang out of a dead tree stump. The old stump symbolized the dead Nimrod. The new evergreen tree symbolized that Nimrod had come to life again in Tammuz. Among the Druids, the oak was sacred. Among the Egyptians, it was the palm. And in Rome, it was the fir, which was decorated with red berries during the Saturnalia. The Scandinavian god Odin was believed to bestow special gifts at Yuletide to those who approached his sacred fir tree. In at least 10 biblical references, the green tree is associated with idolatry and false worship. I'm just going into 1 Kings chapter 14, verse 23 and 24. Quote, for they also built them high places and images and groves on every high hill and under every green tree. And there were also Sodomites in the land, and they did according to all the abominations of the nations which the Lord has cast out before the children of Israel. Unquote. Since all trees are green at least part of the year, the special mention of green probably refers to trees that are evergreen. Quote, the Christmas tree recapitulates the idea of tree worship. Gilded nuts and balls symbolize the sun, the sun. All of the festivities of the winter solstice have been absorbed into Christmas Day. The use of holly and mistletoe from the Druidic ceremonies. The Christmas tree from the honors paid to Odin's sacred fir. Unquote. Taking all of this into consideration, taking all of this into consideration, it is interesting to compare a statement of Jeremiah with today's custom of decorating a tree at the Christmas season. Now we read in Jeremiah 10, verses 3 through 5. Quote, for the customs of the people are vain. For one cutteth the tree out of the forest, the work of the hands of the workmen with the axe. They deck it with silver and with gold, they fasten it with nails and with hammers, that it move not. They are upright as the palm tree, but speak not. They must needs be born, because they cannot go. Be not afraid of them, for they cannot do evil, neither is it in them to do good. Unquote. From Jeremiah. The people in the days of Jeremiah, as the context shows, were actually making an idol out of the tree. The word workman being not merely a lumberjack, but one who formed idols, as we can read in Isaiah chapter 40, verses 19 through 20, and in Hosea chapter 8, verse 46. Now, let me read the quote from Isaiah first. Quote, to whom then will ye liken God? Or what likeness will ye compare unto him? The workman melteth a graven image, and the goldsmith spreadeth it over with gold, and casteth silver chains. He that is so impoverished that he hath no oblation chooses a tree that will not rot. He seeketh unto him a cunning workman to prepare a graven image that shall not be moved. Unquote. And in Hosea chapter 8, we read in the verses 4 through 6, quote, they have set up kings, but not by me. They have made princes, and I knew it not. Of their silver and of their gold have they made them idols, that they may be cut off. Thy calf, O Samaria, hath cast thee off. Mine anger is kindled against them. How long will it be ere they attain to innocency? For from Israel was it also. The workman made it, therefore it is not God, but the calf of Samaria shall be broken in pieces. Unquote. And the word axe refers here specifically to a carving tool. In citing this portion of Jeremiah, we do not mean to infer that people who today place Christmas trees in their homes or churches are worshipping these trees. Well, sometimes they do, eh? Such customs do, however, provide vivid examples of how mixtures have been made. And today we know nothing anymore about these customs of old, and we just make away our own tradition, and everybody thinks that they celebrate Jesus' birth on December 25th. And that what it's all about. First of all, celebrating a birthday that is not subscribed in the Bible, and second of all, on a day which has nothing to do with Bible or biblical belief. Do you see the mixture? Do you see the apostasy coming into your belief system when you do adhere to customs, to traditions like this? Stand fast, therefore, in the liberty wherewith Christ has made us free, and be not entangled again with the yoke of bondage. A verse from the King James Bible that just shot into my mind when I was reading this book, from Galatians chapter 5, verse 1. You know, Anyway, in the 6th century, missionaries were sent through the northern part of Europe to gather sun worshippers into the Roman fold. They found that June 24th was a very popular day among these people. They sought to Christianize this day, but how? By this time, December 25th had been adopted by the Romish Church as the birthday of Christ, since June 24th was approximately 6 months before December 25th. Why not call this birthday of John the Baptist? John was born, it should be remembered, 6 months before Jesus. Thus, June 24th is known on the papal calendar now as Saint John's Day. And as you probably all know, I read the Two Babylons from Alexander Hislop in German, and baptizing of John, or this John the Baptist story, is very well recorded in Alexander Hislop's book. Much deeper, of course, as it is here in this book. But the idea is now to give you a little bit idea of John was born, it should be remembered, 6 months before Jesus, as we can read in Luke chapter 1. Verses 26 through 36. So I'm going to read this to you, and then you know, of course, this coming together. And I thought this was one of the nicest things ever to read in the Bible. You know, when Mary visited her cousin, and the baby jumped in her belly. Anyway, the quote I'm going to give you from Luke. Chapter 1, verse 26 through 36, quote, "And in the sixth month the angel Gabriel was sent from God unto a city of Galilee named Nazareth, to a virgin espoused to a man whose name was Joseph of the house of David, and the virgin's name was Mary. And the angel came in unto her and said, Hail, thou that art highly favored, the Lord is with thee, blessed art thou among women. And when she saw him, she was troubled at his saying, and cast in her mind what manner of salutation this should be. And the angel said unto her, Fear not, Mary, for thou hast found favor with God. And behold, thou shalt conceive in thy womb, and bring forth a son, and shalt call his name Jesus. He shall be great, and shall be called the Son of the Highest, and the Lord, and the Lord shall give unto him the throne of his father David. And he shall reign over the house of Jacob for ever, and of his kingdom there shall be no end. Then said Mary unto the angel, How shall this be, seeing I know not a man? And the angel answered and said unto her, The Holy Ghost shall come upon thee, and the power of the Highest shall overshadow thee. Therefore also that holy thing which shall be born of thee shall be called the Son of God. And behold, thy cousin Elizabeth, she hath also conceived a son in her old age, and this is the sixth month with her, who was called barren." Unquote. You know, and then the story in the Bible continues that Mary visits her cousin, and when she comes there, the baby in her stomach jumps from happiness. And that's the place that I absolutely love. Well, thus June 24th is known on the papal calendar now as St. John's Day. In Britain, before the entrance of Christianity there, June 24th was celebrated by the Druids with blazing fires in honor of Baal. Herodotus, Wilkinson, Layard, and other historians tell of these ceremonial fires in different countries. When June 24th became St. John's Day, the sacred fires were adopted also and became St. John's fires. These are mentioned as such in the Catholic Encyclopedia. Quote, "I have seen the people running and leaping through St. John's fires in Ireland," says a writer of the past century, "proud of passing through unsinged, thinking themselves in a special manner blessed by the ceremony." Unquote. It would seem that such rites would sooner honor Moloch than John the Baptist. Of course, because the God of the Bible says that we should not walk through fire or send anybody even through it. So of course, this is in honor of Moloch instead of the God of the Bible. June 24th was regarded as being sacred to the ancient fish god Oannes, a name by which Nimrod was known. In an article on Nimrod, Fawcett says, quote, Oannes the fish god, Babylon's civilizer, rose out of the Red Sea, unquote. In the Latin language of the Roman Church, John was called Joannes. Notice how similar this is to Oannes. Such similarities helped promote more easily the mixture of Sun, sun worship, into Christianity. A day which in sun worship times had been regarded as sacred to Isis or Diana, August 15th, was simply renamed as the day of the quote-unquote Assumption of the Virgin Mary. I don't know if I said this in one of these readings, but here in Belgium, where I live, in the province of Antwerp, this is their Mother's Day, you know, where the whole world celebrates that somewhere the second Sunday of May, isn't it? They celebrate that in Antwerp on the 15th of August, the day of the Assumption of the Virgin Mary. Yeah. And where is the day of the Assumption of the Virgin Mary in the Bible to be found? Well, that's again another question, right? Okay. Let's read the sentence again. A day which in sun worship times had been regarded as sacred to Isis or Diana, August 15th, was simply renamed as the day of the Assumption of the Virgin Mary, and right up to our present time is still highly honored. Another day adopted from Sun pagan sun worship supposedly to honor Mary is called Candle Mass, or the Purification of the Blessed Virgin, and is celebrated on February 2nd. In Mosaic law, after giving birth to a male child, a mother was considered unclean for 40 days, as we can read in Leviticus 12. Quote, when the days of her purification according to the law of Moses were accomplished, unquote, Joseph and Mary presented the baby Jesus in the temple and offered the prescribed sacrifice, as we can read in Luke 2, chapter 2, verses 22 and 24. But I find it essential to read the complete chapter here because it also confirms that Mary was a poor woman. And you know how the Roman Catholic Church always clothes Mary in gold and silver and precious stones and expensive clothes. But Mary actually was a poor woman. We read in verse 8 what offering should be brought when the woman is poor of lambs, and Mary did just that, as we can read in Luke 2, quote, in verse 22. And when the days of her purification according to the law of Moses were accomplished, they brought him to Jerusalem to present him to the Lord. As it is written in the law of the Lord, every male that openeth the womb shall be called holy to the Lord, and to offer a sacrifice according to that which is set in the law of the Lord, a pair of turtle doves or two pigeons. Unquote. Now the Mosaic law from Leviticus chapter 12, from the King James Version, verses 1 through 8. Quote, and the Lord spake unto Moses, saying, speak unto the children of Israel, saying, if a woman have conceived seed and born a man child, then she shall be unclean 7 days. According to the days of the separation for her infirmity shall she be unclean. And in the eighth day the flesh of his foreskin shall be circumcised. And she shall then continue in the blood of her purifying 33 days. She shall touch no hallowed thing, nor come into the sanctuary, until the days of her purifying be fulfilled. But if she bear a maid child, then she shall be unclean 2 weeks, as in her separation, and she shall continue in the blood of her purifying 66 days. And when the days of her purifying are fulfilled for a son or for a daughter, she shall bring a lamb of the first year for a burnt offering, and a young pigeon or a turtle dove for a sin offering, unto the door of the tabernacle of the congregation unto the priest. who shall offer it before the Lord and make an atonement for her, and she shall be cleansed from the issue of her blood. This is the law for her that hath borne a male or a female. And if she be not able to bring a lamb, as Mary was not when she was not that rich, and if she be not able to bring a lamb, then she shall bring two turtles or two young pigeons, the one for the burnt offering and the other for a sin offering. And the priest shall make an atonement for her, and she shall be clean. So, that was end quote from Leviticus chapter 12. And I find this very important, because Mary was never a rich woman. They didn't even have a place to stay, and her child was lying in the manger, and, you know. But the Roman Catholic Church always depicts Mary as a very rich woman. Well, if she was rich, she could have offered a lamb. She was so poor that she could only offer what God says to do in the place, bring turtles or pigeons, not a lamb. And then the priest made atonement for her, and she was clean. So, okay, I have to continue now in the book. I guess you got the message, eh? Having adopted December 25th as a Nativity of Christ, the February 2 date seemed to fit in well with the time of the purification of Mary, eh? December 25th, February 4th, 40 days? But what did this have to do with the use of candles on this day? In Sun sun-worshipping pagan Rome, this festival was observed by the carrying of torches and candles in honor of February. February, from whom our month February is named. February was the name. The Greeks held the feast in honor of the goddess Ceres, the mother of Proserpina, who, with candle-bearing celebrants, searched for her in the underworld. Thus we can see how adopting February 2nd to honor the purification of Mary was influenced by Sun sun-worshipping pagan customs involving candles, even to calling it Candlemas Day. On this day, all of the candles to be used during the year in Catholic rituals are blessed. They bless candles, okay? An old drawing shows the Pope distributing blessed candles to priests. Says the Catholic Encyclopedia, quote, "We need not shrink from admitting that candles like incense and lustre water were commonly employed in pagan and in rites paid to the dead." Unquote. Listen to the horse's mouth once again. If the Apostle Paul were to be raised up to preach to this generation, we wonder if he would not say to the professing church, as he did to the Galatians long ago, as we can read in Galatians 4, verse 9 through 11, quote, "Howbeit then, when ye knew not God, ye did service unto them which by nature are no gods. But now, after ye have known God, or rather are known of God, how turn ye again to the weak and beggarly elements, whereunto ye desire again to be in bondage? Ye observe days and months and times and years. I am afraid of you, lest I have bestowed upon you labor in vain." Unquote. The context shows that the Galatians had been converted from the sun-worshipping pagan gods. When some had turned again to their former worship, as we can read in verse 9, the days and times they observed were evidently those which had been set aside to honor pagan gods. Later, strangely enough, some of these very days were merged into the worship of the professing church and, quote-unquote, Christianized. So this brings us to the end of chapter 20 with only one chapter to go, but as I see we have reached almost 40 minutes or 40 minutes now. I will leave it up to here. So I will have a little bit shorter video, about 40 minutes, that's okay. And then we can concentrate on the last chapter, chapter 21, which is called The Mystery of the Mixture, as we have mixture in, as we have had mixture, of course, in all of these chapters of this book. I think this is really a wonderful book that opens our eyes, because so many quotes come really right out of the horse's mouth, meaning out of the Roman Catholic Church itself, through the encyclopedias, through the Encyclopedia Britannica, through the Roman Catholic Encyclopedia, and through other writings. And you will know at the end of chapter 1, when I'm done with the book, there are also some interesting quotes that I will read to you that really give us an example that it comes from their own mouth. I mean, we read then from James Cardinal Gibbons, we read from the Roman Catholic Tablet, we read from the Faith of Our Fathers, we read from Pope Gregory the Ninth, and stuff like that at the end of the book. So that's for next time. And I really hope you enjoyed it, and first of all, you've learned a little bit about it. And if you really want to go deeper into the study, I can only advise you to go into Alexander Hislop's book, The Two Babylons, where Ralph Woodrow took a lot from. I read that book in German, I told you already, and this is really going very, very deep into this sun-worshipping and pagan-worshipping gods and rituals, and it's a book I can really advise everybody to read who wants to know more about these lies that rule the world. Don't forget that. It's only the Bible that tells us the truth. Only in the preserved Word of God is the truth to be found in this world, in this day of the world. Okay, thank you very much for listening to chapter 20 of Babylon Mystery Religion. And until next time, Jogler 66 from Hour of the Truth signing off. God bless you and bye-bye.